several leaders of economies today reminded APEC leaders to focus on economic synergy and cooperation on this year's APEC.
Welcome to Boracay, the Philippines' most famous beach.
Covered the journey of our young democracy. In ANC, we were witnesses to the defining moments of Philippine history that influenced the world.
Sa paglilingkod sa bansa.
Talk to leaders. We don't shy away from difficult conversations.
ANC Leadership Series.
We report about disruption and how the latest technology and innovation have changed the way we live.
Told stories about crisis, but also about opportunities that came with it.
The Philippines.
And we are ANC.
What do you think Congress failed to do at that time in order for the country to avoid having a broken transport system? With what is happening on the ground, with what is happening in the West Philippine Sea, are fishermen being driven away from their traditional fishing grounds? This doesn't add up.
How is this affecting the morale of the force? Tell us, what is it about the system there that really allows this impunity to exist? Is the Philippine government entirely powerless in this situation?
Your no-nonsense noontime news fix on ANC. Dateline Philippines with Carmina Constantino. Weekdays at 12 noon, only on ANC.
Safety after an earthquake. Be prepared for aftershocks. Don't enter buildings until they're declared safe by experts. Check yourself and others for injuries. Check your plumbing for leaks. Check electrical lines throughout the house. Watch out for fires, fire hazards, or spilled chemicals. Monitor the news. Arm yourself with information. A friendly reminder from ANC.
The biggest news, the most compelling stories, and issues that matter to you.
Top Story, Monday to Saturday at 5 p.m. here on ANC.
Take the lead even when on the go. Keep abreast of the latest news and information with the ABS-CBN News app. receive news alerts, audio stream DZML, and customize your news feed. All these and more with the ABS-CBN News app. Download the ABS-CBN News app now, available on Google Play Store and the App Store.
This is where newsmakers answer to you.
Itong paper na we get from the Hague decision, pwede naman nila punitin yon. So diplomacy, that's the only way to do it.
Tapos ang panahon ni Duterte, pero hanggang ngayon hindi pa rin tapos ang pagkikialam ng mga banyaga na yan dito sa ating bansa.
This is where headlines are made.
The country must free itself from endemic corruption. Malaysia should not be known because of these various past scandals.
This is where we do the news.
The future of the Philippines, the security of the Philippines, the well-being of Filipinos is important to us as allies.
This isn't just talk.
That is not a surplus because the profits are earmarked.
I watched your interview with Congressman Ed Seligman.
Thank you.
This morning, or that there are other sovereigns.
Describes COVID.
But wow, oh my God.
Then I apologize.
You need to clarify the issue.
What he really want to find out.
Thank you much for this interview, you, sir.
Thank you.
Really. This is Head Start.
Hi everyone, I'm Nikki De Guzman. It's 9 a.m. in Manila, 10 a.m. in Tokyo, and 12 noon in Sydney. The headlines. Asian markets open mixed with Wall Street closed for a holiday on the first trading day of the week. Now here at home, the PSE index kicks off from 6508 after a strong close last Friday. The UK's developing countries trading scheme takes effect today. We'll talk about that with British Ambassador to the Philippines, Lord Bofis. And U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken and Chinese Foreign Minister Qin Gang hold what they call candid and constructive talks in Beijing. Asian markets open mixed on the first trading day of the week as investors look for direction, with Wall Street closed on a holiday today, Monday. Japan's Nikkei down nearly 0.5% in early trade, while the South Korean KOSPI is seeing bigger losses. Australia's ASX 200 bucking the downtrend, up about 0.25%. Investors in the region also digesting news out of China, where U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken is meeting with Chinese officials. Here's how Wall Street closed last Friday. The S&P 500 broke its six-day winning streak as the major U.S. indices fell after two Federal Reserve officials curtailed optimism the central bank is nearing the end of its aggressive interest rate hikes. Now, despite that, the S&P 500 and the Nasdaq still closed out the week with their best weekly performance since March. More on U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken's trip to China. The U.S. official met with Chinese Foreign Minister Qin Gang and held what they call both candid and constructive talks in Beijing. But after a 7.5-hour meeting, the two sides seemed to agree on little beyond keeping the conversation going with an eventual meeting in Washington. Now, according to a statement from the U.S. State Department, Blinken raised a number of issues of concern as well as opportunities to explore cooperation. He also made it clear Washington will work with its allies and partners for a free and open international rules-based order. Now, meanwhile, speaking after the meeting, China said it regards Taiwan as the most important issue and greatest risk. Blinken is the first top American diplomat to visit China in 5 years. Here's a quick look at the flash business headlines from overseas. In other news, SVB Financial Group set to sell its investment banking division, SVB Securities, to Bidder Group, led by CEO Jeff Leerink and backed by hedge fund, the Bopost Group. Now, the group will acquire the investment banking business, excluding the company's research business, for a combination of cash repayment of an intercompany note and a 5% equity instrument. Now, the deal comes after the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation took over Silicon Valley Bank in March after depositors rushed to pull out their money in a bank run that triggered the worst U.S. banking crisis since 2008. U.S. chipmaker Intel, meanwhile, will invest $25 billion in a new factory in Israel, the largest investment ever made by an international company in the country. Now, the factory is due to open in 2027, set to operate through 2035, and is expected to employ thousands of people. During its almost five decades of operations in Israel, Intel has grown to become the country's largest privately held employer and exporter, and a leader of the local electronics and information industry. Now, the lawyer who quit defending former President Donald Trump in the criminal classified documents case also withdraws from the separate $475 million defamation lawsuit against news network CNN. Now, attorney Jim Trusty cited irreconcilable differences with Trump as the reason behind his withdrawal. Trump accused CNN of running a smear campaign against him, including comparing him to Adolf Hitler. Trump is still represented by legal counsel in Florida. And finally, Elon Musk announces a Twitter video app for smart TVs is coming, a move that would be in line with the company's new plans to focus on growing video content on the platform. The app's new CEO, Linda Yaccarino, and Musk earlier laid out plans for Twitter, focusing on video, creator, and commerce partnerships to revitalize the company beyond digital advertising. After Musk acquired Twitter in October, the social media firm faced months of chaos, including layoffs of thousands of employees, criticism over lax content moderation, and an exodus of many advertisers who did not want their ads appearing next to inappropriate content. Now, in news here at home, the Philippine Coast Guard insists they refused to be intimidated when a Chinese Navy ship shadowed one of their vessels. The incident happened last Friday as a BRP Francisco Dacohoy was returning to Palawan after it helped the Fisheries Bureau deliver livelihood assistance to residents on Pag-asa Island. The Coast Guard spokesperson on the West Philippine Sea, Jay Tariela, says their personnel did not stop issuing a radio challenge to the Chinese Navy to insist that they were encroaching on Philippine territory. The Chinese vessel finally stopped tailing the Coast Guard ship after 10 nautical miles from the island.
That's the usual practice that they have been doing naman. For so many occasions, we have already reported this, no? Na ang AIS ng Chinese Coast Guard, even the Philippine Navy vessel, ay pinapatay nila. Sa Pag-asa po, ay meron tayong 12 nautical miles sa territorial. Hindi sir, dahil tayo po ay may dito sa territorial sea natin dito sa Pag-asa. AIS is a requirement ng international convention. It would be proper kung sakaling lahat tayo ay naka-turn on ng ating mga AIS. Kasi this has something to do with safety, no? For other vessels to monitor your presence.
Now, Beijing claims sovereignty over almost the entire South China Sea, rather ignoring an international ruling that they assert has no legal basis. The Philippines recently accused China of causing a near crash with a Coast Guard ship and pointing a military-grade laser at another vessel. Because of Chinese incursions in the West Philippine Sea, the fish catch of Filipino fishermen have been affected. Now, according to the Bureau of Fisheries, the West Philippine Sea accounts for 6% of the country's total fisheries production as of 2022. That's equivalent to over 275,000 metric tons. But the agency says the single-digit figure could be higher if Filipino fishermen aren't being harassed by Chinese boats.
Posible ba na tumaas ang production ng WPS kung wala ang mga isyong ito na nangyayari doon? I would say yes. Kung ano man yung mga hindering factors na nangyayari ngayon at kapag nawala ito, ay magiging manganghulugan ito na mas malilinang natin ang yaman ng West Philippine Sea. We are not downplaying na hindi malaki ang significance ng West Philippine Sea sa ating overall fisheries production and in terms of food security.
Data from the BFAR shows there are over 376,000 fishermen in the West Philippine Sea as of January this year. Now, to help them, the BFAR will launch an 80 million peso livelihood project for fisherfolk there, dubbed the Layag WPS Project. The beneficiaries cover fisherfolk from the regions of Ilocos, Central Luzon, and Mipanropa. The UK's new trading scheme takes effect today, with the program expected to save Philippine exports 1.4 billion pesos in tariffs in a year. Let's talk about the so-called developing countries trading scheme with UK Ambassador Laure Bulfields. Good morning, Ambassador. Pleasure to have you on the show.
Good morning, Nikki, and it's a pleasure to be here.
All right. So first off, it was since announced last June 7th during the launch of the DCTS that it'll take effect June 19. That's today. Now, remind us what the UK's new unilateral preferences scheme will do for our trading ties. We're among the 65 countries who will be enjoying the new developing countries trading scheme. What kind of trading atmosphere and alliance will foster among the countries involved?
Brilliant. Thank you. So the DCTS, as you say, is our new trading scheme. In effect, it replaces what we used to have under GSP Plus. And what we've done as the UK is we've consulted very widely over the period of a year and a half to understand what should replace GSP Plus and build on it to be even more attractive to exporters in countries such as the Philippines. And there are three things that distinguish DCTS from its predecessor. First of all, we've added a lot of lines. So there's 150 new products that are part of the scheme for which there will be no duties or tariffs going into the UK. A significant example is on tuna products, where there used to be 20% duties and there will no longer be any. So it will be much more attractive for exporters to export tuna into the UK. But we've also simplified rules of origin. And last but not least, we've removed conditions. So there are no additional hoops to jump through, if you like, for exporters that are wanting to export to the UK. So as a result of that, we find that it will be much more attractive and financially viable for exporters to export to the UK. And we expect to be able to significantly boost our trade, as you were saying.
Mm-hmm, agreed. And Ambassador, based on research into the UK retailers and consumers' buying considerations and insights as well from Filipino producers, financiers, policymakers, what are some of the highest potential value chains and products that can benefit from the new scheme?
Well, lots of interest in agriculture, you won't be surprised to hear. So tuna is a case in point, but also tropical fruits, products deriving from cocoa in particular will be particularly attractive. And then some others like t-shirts or electronic products that I think will be very, very attractive and where we can expect exports to go up.
Mm-hmm. And we know that the UK is launching the DCTS to replace the generalized scheme of preferences, right, with the aim to grow free and fair trade with selected countries. What were the pitfalls of this previously implemented scheme?
I don't think we can necessarily talk about pitfalls, but obviously the UK left the European Union, and as such, we had the independence and the liberty to be able to develop our own scheme, and that's what we've done. So I wouldn't talk about the pitfalls of the previous scheme, but rather the advantages of this current scheme, and that's what makes it particularly attractive.
Mm-hmm. And during the June 7 launch, the program also included some presentations on customs, processes, and agricultural standards for Philippine exporters. How would you say are we doing in that department?
Well, I think there's a lot of progress that's being made. I think there's a lot of interest. It was wonderful to have Secretary Pascual join us at the launch, and we spoke about all that's being done to address market access challenges and to ensure that the standards were met. And I know there's a lot of effort that's being done. And we will continue to work hand in hand with the government of the Philippines on some of these issues, whether that be in agriculture or in other sectors.
Mm-hmm. And Ambassador, can you give us an overview of the UK market purchasing criteria as well as the barriers to trade? We know the UK DCTS is one of the most generous trading preference scheme in the world, but why is enabling the Philippines to have continued access to enhanced preferences important for all parties involved?
Well, I think it's important because it's just a way to facilitate free trade. And we, as now an independent country that is no longer in the EU, want to be a country that further supports free and open trade. The DCTS is a way to do that. We will be continuing to work with partners to find innovative ways to do that. It's important for us because we want to increase our trade bilaterally. This is mostly about exports from countries such as the Philippines into the UK. And I know it's very important for the Philippines to have balanced trade, mm-hmm. where exports and imports are balanced. And this is our initiative to make sure that that's possible. It's not something that a country has to opt into or sign up to. It's really just for exporters to take advantage of this. So what we want to do is really raise awareness around the opportunities. And that's why we had this launch in the Philippines that you mentioned on the 7th of June. And that's why we're reaching out to as many Filipino businesses as possible, exporters as possible, to make them aware of the scheme and to say, well, as of today, you can benefit from it. And there were 250 companies that participated in the scheme. And the great news is that there's a lot of interest beyond these companies. We've had banks come to us saying that their clients are interested in finding out more. So we're doing lots and lots of briefing to make sure companies know of the opportunities, know what additional product lines are being considered, and that they can really use those additional routes to further boost their exports.
Mm-hmm. And jumping off from that, Ambassador, how do our businesses then take full advantage of this new scheme? How can our government encourage them to do so?
So it's about raising awareness. There's, in a way, there's nothing that they've got to sign up to. They've just got to use existing forms that are quite simple and quite straightforward when they export. And then they what will happen is that they will more often than not have to have these additional duties that will be removed. So in effect, for importers importing into the UK, goods from the Philippines will be cheaper. If there are no tariffs, that means that, you know, no tariffs on tuna, for example, the tuna that you import from the Philippines into the UK mm-hmm. become cheaper, which makes it much more attractive for British importers to buy Filipino tuna. So I think the point for exporters here is awareness. And for them to engage in conversations with UK importers. UK importers will also be doing that because, of course, they've been briefed about the scheme and they know what countries are the ones that are producing products that are particularly advantageous and attractive and in demand in the UK. So we expect these conversations to happen. Our role is really about awareness raising, making sure companies here and in the UK are aware of the scheme.
And Ambassador, looking at the numbers last year, we know trade between the Philippines and the UK reached an all-time high of £2.4 billion in 2022. What was this attributed to, and how can we sustain this?
So that's a really good question. Well, first of all, you're right. It's never been as high. We've not just got back to pre-pandemic levels, but increased levels from mm-hmm. what it was ever before. We've seen a lot of increase in agricultural products as part of our trade. In particular, from the UK into the Philippines, we've seen increase in pork and chicken and other agricultural products. And from the Philippines to the UK, we've seen increases in electronic goods in particular. But I think there's just generally, quite frankly, a greater awareness across the two markets. And that's through the work that the embassy in London has done, the Filipino embassy, and the work that we're doing here, making sure that where there were information asymmetries or lack of understanding and knowledge, we're addressing those so that the attractiveness of British products is better known here and vice versa. And so I think I would attribute the increased trade to that. And the more we get that understanding, the more we have those first movers, the more we think that that trade can grow. So you're right, we're at £2.4 billion right now, but we think it can further grow. And I'm confident that the DCTS will play a big part of that.
Mm-hmm. And based on projections, how much can Philippine businesses potentially save in a year on UK export tariffs? Why is this a major milestone in opening up new trade and investment opportunities between our countries?
Well, you said it yourself, Nikki. We're looking at 1.4 billion pesos mm-hmm. Savings, which is not negligible, and that's just from the scheme. But what we're also doing is, as I mentioned earlier, thinking of other routes, additional investments. We're really looking at a few key sectors where there are particular opportunities and bringing businesses to the Philippines. We've brought the members of the Philippine government to the UK for different trade missions. So we're really working on all fronts, if you like, to boost our trade.
And now, Ambassador, let's talk about the recently ended London Tech Week. This is a global celebration of tech and a week-long festival, right? And it has just celebrated its 10-year anniversary. Who did we see there? What were some of the key takeaways from there?
Yes, you're absolutely right. It was a really exciting week. In fact, London Tech Week is Europe's largest tech festival, and there were some 20,000 government and corporate leaders and startup founders and senior investors, rising stars of tech, you name it. They were all there, and we were absolutely delighted that there was a large delegation from the Philippines. In fact, the largest delegation we've ever had. We had 25 very senior people come from the Philippines representing big companies from Kickstart Ventures and GCash and Digital Pilipinas, Metro Pacific, etc. And they were all there basically to discuss opportunities for greater partnerships mm-hmm. in tech. The themes that were particularly prioritized this year were green innovation, health technology, and digital transformation. And there were great opportunities for matchmaking, pitching for investors, trying to understand capabilities. So for example, our capabilities as the UK in terms of artificial intelligence. And this is what this week was about, a lot of business to business as well as business to policymaker interactions. And in terms of the specifics from the Philippines, it was really exciting to see that Kickstart Ventures announced a multi-million-dollar investment into a company in the UK called Rosslyn Tech. And Rosslyn Tech invests in biotechnology to basically create proteins, mm-hmm. Manufacture protein non-meat products. Which is very much in line with what Kickstart Venture wants to do in general. And in this case, it's about food security and looking after the planet. And so this is a kind of really exciting type of initiative or ventures that come out of weeks such as London Tech Week and that we're really excited about.
Mm-hmm. And also representing us this year from the Philippines, we had RCBC Executive VP and Chief Innovation and Inclusion Officer and FinTech Alliance Founding Chairman Lito Villanueva participating last week for the London Tech Week, where he said Filipinos have more spaces to determine the mold of the digital future. What are your thoughts on this?
I think that's absolutely right. I think there's so much happening in this ecosystem right now in the Philippines. It's so vibrant, so active. The real opportunities to leapfrog stages of development through technology. We know that whether it is across the government sector or the private sector, digital transformation is absolutely essential to grow and to reach all parts of society. And then the Philippines, the digital transformation piece is incredibly important given the geography of the country, given the 7,600 islands. And to reach everyone in this in the country, you will need those digital innovations, you will need artificial intelligence, you will need new tools. So tech is really very much at the heart of that. But tech is also about new and extraordinary fast developing opportunities, for example, in health. New technologies can address, can spot diseases in
elections, Ambassador. It could play a big role, even in elections.
Absolutely, in all parts of life. And mm-hmm. this is why a week like London Tech Week is so important for government and for private sector and for innovators to come together, because it's really about business opportunities, but it's also about thinking about what kind of future we want collectively and reflecting on that. And it's also about talking about regulation of tech as and when appropriate.
All right, all exciting things ahead from trade to tech. Thank you for joining us again. It's been our pleasure, Ambassador Lor. You stay safe.
Thank you for having me.
Now up next, we'll talk to BDO Capital's Ed Francisco for his market outlook for the week. Market Edge will be right back. Stock Exchange kicks off trading at 65.08 after logging its third weekly gain last week. Now joining us for today for his take on the market is BDO Capital President Ed Francisco. Hi, Ed. Good morning.
Hi, good morning.
All right. So first off, let's take a look at equities. We ended last week bouncing back to the 6,500 level with a significantly high value turnover at $53 billion. Now, how do you think trading's going to go for today with U.S. markets closed for a holiday? Any reason to be more bullish this week?
Right. No, I think last week there was an aberration. There was a large property dividend by BPI and a little exuberance at the end, but we shall be going back to the maybe 3 to 5 billion daily this week. And then I guess we'll just be waiting for more news, especially on the BSP rates later this week. It will be sideways, I think, until we see positive news from the BSP.
So we also know that BSP will be having their interest rate policy meeting this week on the 22nd. What do you think would be their best view moving forward, and what will it take to move the index higher?
Right. Of course, they've made announcements that they don't necessarily will move lockstep with the Fed. We're seeing good news from the U.S. where inflation is going down already, and I guess some of the job growth is there. In the Philippines, I think our expectation for this week is that they will probably not change the rates. Of course, ideally, we want the rates to start going down, which will probably happen later this year or early next year. But if rates stay flat, and then at least inflation goes down, that's the signal that we want. And then the economy will continue to improve, and the stock market will improve.
So there's the waiting for inflation. Now, Ed, we know the European Central Bank is taking the opposite stance from the Fed in terms of pausing with the rate increases and instead hiking them. How long do you think this decision would affect market sentiment?
Yeah, well, the Europe is a little different now already. I guess from the global scenario, we don't have, I guess, the impact of Europe, especially for the Philippines, is not as large as it is from the of movements of the U.S. and China. So we're a little immune. We'll just watch closely, but at least it won't have that big a bearing for us. It's really the U.S. When they catch a cold, and now we have pneumonia, right?
And how much of the economic reality do the prices of our stock market right now actually reflect? What does this say about the Philippine equity market?
No, that is a very good question. We have lots of discussions of that, especially among the BDO senior management team. The PSE is a very, very good indicator, right, for the stock market. But it is not really representing, in a way, the true economy. It's good that, for example, the index is still very undervalued, or it has been moving sideways. But the economy has been still relatively strong, right? Even if GDP growth slows down to 5 or 5.5%. Compared to the region or compared to the world, we're one of the top performers. So the index might be flat, but the real growth in the country is much, much better. So I just wanted to dissociate that. But in a way, it also shows that there are really good buys still in the index, right, in the Philippine companies, because we're still relatively undervalued. People have left, especially the foreigners, when in reality we're doing so well.
All right. Meanwhile, let's also take a look at foreign buying. Seems like the selling trend has been persisting lately, but looking at the numbers as we ended last week, do you think we'll be seeing a long-term reversal soon, also with the pausing of hikes by the Fed?
Yeah, I think last week there was some improvement. There was a little of the foreign buying already. I guess in the next 6 months, especially as rates, I guess, pause, and later on, maybe next year, they start declining, then we will see the foreign buying coming again. They should come in earlier, because if they come in when you already peaked, then it'll be too late, right? I mean, these are astute, sophisticated buyers, especially the foreigners. I think they should be coming a little early. So hopefully by second half of this year, which is right, second half, right? Then they should be starting to come in. During our roadshows and presentations to foreign investors, they've been asking a lot of questions, and I think they're positioning already. We're seeing already, right, the economy improving, inflation going down. So the stocks that are that will improve because of a reduction in inflation, and then also cheaper prices. They will benefit. So these investors, sophisticated, whether local or foreign, should start buying these companies.
Mm-hmm. So you did mention earlier that the PSE is only one aspect of the economy. So let's zero in on corporate earnings and the GDP growth numbers. How much of a hit have we seen the Philippines take? You know, high inflation, high interest rates. Does the consumer remain strong still and the economy robust?
Yeah, no, the economy is still robust, very strong. There has been some slowdown, right? Because that is, in my case, my validation is really talking to our clients, right? They've experienced, of course, margin squeezes, right? They've started to pass some of it already, not been able to pass a lot of it because it will hurt also the end user. But at least their corporate earnings have been improving, right? So it shows you that, you know, that despite higher commodity prices, cement prices, metal prices, for example, right, for construction, even interest rates have gone up, so it's made it a little more challenging to buy a condo. Car sales have been going up. Housing sales have been, condo sales have been going up outside, especially outside Manila. So there's optimism there. People are still optimistic. So the key really is, you know, we just have to be more comfortable. Consumer sentiment is there. They were a little afraid to spend earlier, but things are getting better. And as long as we're positive, and as long as there are no big problems outside the country, because in the Philippines, we're generally doing very well, but no major hiccups in the China economy or in the U.S., there's no recession, then we're positioned for a great takeoff.
And given that, can you give us your assessment on how the successive rate hikes affected the Philippine growth? And at the rate that we're going, how many rate hikes do you think we'll be seeing on the table this year?
Okay. No, yeah, the rate hikes have really affected the last few rate hikes have affected us, right? That's why we've slowed down our growth, right? We were really looking hopefully at 7-8% already GDP growth, but because of the rate hikes, it slowed down to 6, and now it might even slow down to 5-5.5. Having said that, compared to other countries, our 5-5.5 is still much better than the rest of the world. And then in terms of succeeding rate hikes, I don't think they will pause indefinitely. There might be another one or two more rate hikes this year. But if the U.S. is doing well and hopefully we're able to control inflation, and the BSP, of course, an earlier one than really 2-4% inflation targeting, right? But now I think they're also willing to live with a little higher inflation as long as it's going down, right? Then that should be acceptable. We don't have to really target the 2-3% or 2-4%. If it ends up average at 4-5%, that at least on the downtrend, that's okay. So growth numbers, GDP numbers are improving. Even the remittances, we had good remittance numbers the other day. People are remitting again, and a lot of it is coming from the U.S. So there's support there. We're also seeing BPO growth. So at least these are the drivers. Of consumption, and then the investment should be coming in because the government is spending also, right? We're seeing a pickup in discussions of all these big projects. So holistically, at least the pieces of the jigsaw are in place. So just put them all together, and then at least it will strengthen the economy of the country.
And that said, Sir Ed, you've since said that we should be a little more comfortable with uncertainties, especially since things are at least slowly looking up. But where do you see inflation going, looking at the pace that it's been moving? What other current risks that you think people should at the very least be concerned about?
No, yes, inflation at least should be going down. But yes, admittedly, the big components of our inflation are, of course, fuel and I guess the prices of goods, right? So if we're not able to manage well prices, let's say for rice and onions as an example, that will cause inflation to go up. So hopefully that's something that the Department of Agriculture can time, you know. If we have to import, let's import, but let's import at the right time and make sure that it doesn't kill the local farmers. And then, of course, fuel is harder to manage because it's really hard to hedge. But hopefully fuel prices stay where they are. Anyway, the U.S. and even all these Russia concerns are hopefully won't signal a war and then suddenly oil prices go up significantly. China would be a big play, but I think the oil prices are more manageable. It's really the food prices that have to be managed. Mm-hmm. So as long as those are managed, or at least fuel, and then the food prices are controlled, then inflation will go down already. Mm-hmm. And it will go down hopefully to 4 or 5% in the near term. So that's the target.
And Ed, let's take a look at currency now. Do you see it retreating towards the, let's say, higher 50s? What will be the major factors contributing to how the peso would fare?
Of course, if the U.S. continues to increase rates and then we don't, immediately our peso depreciates, right? The BSP has already stated anyway the third bigger concern is inflation and not managing the FX rate, the peso rate. So I guess they're willing to let the peso depreciate a bit. So even our own BDO forecast, if end of the year, if peso stays between 55 to 56, that is acceptable. We're not seeing the peso depreciate, I guess, further than 56.50 anyway. So, but we don't also see it strengthening to 54 or 53. Mm-hmm. Because I guess the peso now is more an after effect. It's inflation that we're really more concerned with. Of course, a weaker peso is very good for the OFWs, but it also has an impact on importation costs. But in the bigger scheme of things, as long as inflation goes down, then that, I guess, that's the signal that the economy will do well.
Mm-hmm. And given all that was mentioned, we're just halfway through the year. Lately, we've been range trading for quite some time, and we haven't really been breaching the resistance we've set in near term at 6,700. How do you think we'll finish the first half of 2023?
Yeah, it'll probably stay where it is because we're not, or at least I personally am not seeing any big signal for the big influx of foreign investors, right? Of course, we're waiting for the sauna, but at least things are moving in the right direction. But there's no big stimulus or no big catalyst that we see. Unless for some miracle, if we announce that our inflation is down already from 6+ to 4%, then that will really stimulate the markets. But I don't see that happening, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or if suddenly we see the Ukraine war and suddenly they agree with Putin that there'll be peace negotiations.
Yeah.
Those are the big things that will affect that really stimulate the economy. I don't see that happening. So in the meantime, it's just going to be sideways. And because it's going to be moving sideways, the 6.4 to 6.6 levels are what we're seeing really. I don't see it significantly going up. But at the same time, they're also testing the waters, right? Some people are trying to see how further to go down. But on the other hand, it's good to see that the corporates are resilient. So at least they're delivering and they're making money. There's some growth. The banks are doing well. Other industries are doing well. So, I mean, the corporates are doing well as they are, regardless of valuations. So that will support the stock levels, that will support the index. But they won't significantly go up unless the whole sentiment, the global sentiment, and the consumer sentiment changes. Despite the corporates doing well, if the global sentiments are weak and therefore they won't focus on emerging markets in the Philippines, then the stock market won't really zoom. That's the way I see it.
Mm-hmm. All right, lastly, before I let you go, what companies, again, should people be buying? Are the golden days of financials over? What's looking attractive to you right now? Any particular stock you're monitoring closely?
Sure. No, in general, the themes, of course, the financial sector will continue to do well as rates might still go up. And even if they stay where they are, it's relatively elevated. So the banks will do well. You've seen that. The numbers are very good. Now, the thing that changed, in the past, we were a little more cautious on consumer. But now, because of the, of course, hopefully reducing inflation, so goods will be cheaper and consumer sentiment stronger. That's where the food companies like, the Jollibees, the URCs will be doing well. The Shakey's, the Max's, people are going out, people are eating. So that's going to be strong. And of course, even the you've seen the numbers of cars. So you know the conglomerates with cars like GE, the GE Capital Group should be doing very well, aside from the other conglomerates. So it's relatively positive. There will be some pickups already, but those with, I guess, with some real estate, selected real estate, with financial sector and consumers are the ones with the growth sectors.
All right. As always, pleasure talking to you. Ed Francisco, BDO Capital President. You stay safe.
Thank you.
Now on to more news. Pakistan is facing a debt crisis. It must pay billions in debt servicing, but the state's coffers are almost empty. As this report tells us, hopes of reviving a stalled 2019 International Monetary Fund bailout program are fading.
Glittering gold jewelry, colorful fabrics, delicious street food. In Pakistan's bazaars, this is business as usual. But the country of almost 230 million people is in a debt crisis. Just this month, Pakistan needs to pay back $3.6 billion in external loans. While it has paid some and expects most of it to be rolled over, the government still must find a way to pay $900 million. The state has barely $4 billion in foreign exchange reserves.
The likelihood of rollover of those payments, particularly by China, is almost certain. In which case, inshallah, we will not default, inshallah, by the end of this month, June.
A revival of a stalled 2019 bailout deal with the International Monetary Fund that would unlock more than $1 billion appears increasingly unlikely. That program ends June 30 with Pakistan's fiscal year. Finance Minister Ishaq Dar says even without the IMF's help, Pakistan will meet its financial obligations.
We have sovereign commitments which the past government made. They are not PTI's or Imran Khan's. They are Pakistani's commitments. I think even at the cost of paying a political price, we must meet those obligations, and we have.
To save precious dollar reserves, the government has been curtailing imports.
I think that was not a good policy because our economy is dependent, our exports are dependent on imports, imported raw material. So when that raw material was not in the country, that was not coming in, the exports were affected too much.
Pakistan's credit rating is already poor. Former Finance Minister Hafiz Pasha says the lack of an IMF deal will rattle the markets.
The greater instability in the exchange rate and the inflation rate could thereby be also affected.
That means more pain for Pakistanis who are already dealing with a record 38% annual inflation rate. Some experts say, in many ways, Pakistan has already defaulted.
We are not letting the payments to go out the country, whether it by dividends or it by people sending for their kids. Many people are sending money outside Pakistan through informal means. Many businesses are moving out, many people are migrating out of the Pakistan. So we haven't really defaulted technically on our debt, but we have defaulted on many grounds.
Pakistan's debt crisis will not end with the fiscal year. Starting in July, the country has to manage nearly $25 billion of external loan repayments over the next 12 months. Sara Zaman, VOA News, Islamabad. We'll be right back.
Time to zip through the top headlines from major business papers from Business World. The International Monetary Fund says the Philippine government should prioritize telco and energy to boost economic growth. From Business Mirror, investments in the Philippine tourism industry reached 364 billion pesos in 2022 as hotel developers resumed projects that were affected by the pandemic. The Mirror cited data from the Philippine Statistics Authority, which showed investments in hotels and resorts accounted for some 44% of total investments in the tourism industry. And from the Wall Street Journal, Pixar's latest animated film, Elemental, fails to spark audiences in its opening weekend. The $200 million animated rom-com earned an estimated $29.5 million at the box office. That's one of the weakest domestic debuts in the studio's history. And right before we go, a heads up for customers of Water Concessionaire Maynilad in Quezon City. Portions of the city will experience service interruptions starting tonight, 10 p.m. to 4 a.m. Tuesday. This as Maynilad will repair a leak along Commonwealth Avenue. Now, according to the company, 151,000 service connections will be affected, including those in Greater Fairview, Holy Spirit, and North Fairview. And that's it for the show. I'm Nikki De Guzman. Thank you for watching. You can listen to our interviews again on the ANC Market Edge podcast, available on Spotify. You can also watch highlights, recaps, exclusive contents of our shows online. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. Stay safe and stay with ANC.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide
the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.